Have you ever wondered how large networks communicate over wide areas? Today, we will delve into the world of wide area networks, or WANs. So what exactly is a WAN? Imagine a city with various office buildings. Each building has its own local area network or LAN, but these buildings need to communicate, share data, and access resources. This is where WANs come into play. A WAN is a network that spans a large geographical area, often a city, a country, or even the entire globe. It's like a superhighway connecting different LANs, allowing them to communicate and share resources. The internet, the largest WAN, is a perfect example. It connects networks worldwide, enabling global communication and information exchange. But why are WANs important? Two words: connectivity and efficiency. In today's digital age, businesses are spread across various locations. A software company in San Francisco might have a development team in Bangalore, a customer service center in Manila, and data centers in Dublin. WANs enable these disparate teams to collaborate in real time, sharing data and resources efficiently. Now you might be wondering, how does a WAN differ from a LAN? While both are networks, their scale and scope are vastly different. A LAN is confined to a small geographical area, like a single building or a campus. It's like your home's Wi-Fi network. On the other hand, a WAN can span continents, connecting networks across the globe. Another key difference lies in ownership. LANs are typically owned and managed by the organization using them. WANs, however, often involve multiple networks owned by different entities. Think of it as renting a lane on a highway. You don't own the highway, but you pay to use it. That's a brief overview of WANs. Now let's move on to a more specific networking protocol used in WANs, the point-to-point protocol, or PP. So what is PPP? It's not just a random combination of letters, but a crucial protocol in networking. Let's delve into the world of point-to-point protocol. Commonly known as PPP, this protocol is a fundamental piece of the networking puzzle, playing a key role in establishing and maintaining direct connections between two nodes. Imagine for a moment that you're trying to set up a conversation between two people in different locations. They need a direct, uninterrupted line of communication to effectively exchange information. That's where PPP comes in. It acts as the bridge, enabling these two parties to communicate seamlessly across the network. Now you might be asking, why is PPP so important? The answer lies in its functionality. PPP not only establishes the connection, but also ensures data is transported reliably across it. It's like a trusted courier, making sure your information gets where it needs to go, safely and accurately. Another reason for PPP's significance is its versatility. It can be used over various physical mediums, including twisted pair, fiber optic, or even satellite transmission. This adaptability makes it a popular choice in diverse networking environments. One of the key things to remember about PPP is that it operates at the data link layer, or layer 2 of the OSI model. This means it's responsible for data encoding and decoding and maintaining the logical link between nodes. Now, let's talk about where PPP is used. You'll typically find it in action in dial-up internet connections, where it facilitates the direct connection between the user's computer and the internet service provider. But that's not all. It's also used in various network scenarios, like VPN connections and GSM networks, to name a few. So, when you think about PPP, remember it's not just another acronym. It's a vital player in the networking game, bridging the gap between nodes, ensuring reliable data transport, and offering versatility in its application. That's a brief overview of PPP. Next, we'll explore how to configure and verify PPP. Now that we know what PPP is, how do we configure it? Well, configuring PPP is a relatively straightforward process, but it's crucial to understand the steps involved. Let's delve into the process. The first step involves setting up a serial interface on your router. This is where your WAN connection will be established. For example, you might use the command interface serial 0 to set up your first serial interface. Remember, the numbering starts from 0 in Cisco routers. Next, you'll want to specify the encapsulation method. In our case, we'll use the point-to-point protocol, or PP. This is done by entering the command encapsulation PPPP. This tells the router that we're using PPP as our protocol for data encapsulation over the serial interface. Now, it's time to set up authentication. PPP supports two types of authentication: password authentication protocol, or PAP, and challenge handshake authentication protocol, or CHAP. PAP is less secure as it sends passwords over the network in plain text, while CHAP uses a three-way handshake and encryption for added security. For instance, to set up CHAP authentication, you'd use the command PPP authentication CHAP. If you're using PAP, replace CHAP with PAP in the command. Next, you'll need to set a username and password for authentication. This is done using the username command followed by the username and the secret command followed by the password. For example, username TechSpectrumPro secret my password. It's also important to mention that the username should match the hostname of the other router and vice versa. This is because in a PPP session, each router will send its hostname as its identity during the authentication phase. The final step in configuring PPPP is to bring up the interface with the no shutdown command. This tells the router that we're ready to start sending and receiving data over the interface. It's important to note that the configuration process needs to be completed on both routers involved in the PPP connection. And remember, the usernames and passwords must match on both routers for the authentication process to succeed. In summary, we've set up a serial interface, specified PPP as our encapsulation method, set up authentication, and finally brought up the interface. It's a straightforward process, but each step is crucial in ensuring a successful PPP connection. Keep in mind that, like any configuration process, it's essential to understand what each command does and why it's used. This not only helps in troubleshooting, but also allows you to adapt the process to different networking scenarios. After configuring PPP, the next step is to verify that it's working as expected. Let's see how to do that. Scene script. Verification is a critical step in any configuration process. But how do we verify PPP? After configuring the point-to-point protocol, or PPP, the next crucial step is verification. This ensures the configuration was done correctly and the network is functioning as intended. To verify PPP, we use specific commands. These commands are entered into the command line interface, or CLI, of the networking device, like a router or a switch. The first command we use is the simple show interfaces command. This command displays the status of all interfaces on the device. You'll see if the interface is up or down and if the line protocol is up or down. If both are up, it's a good sign that your PPP is functioning correctly. Next, we use the show IP interface brief command. This command provides a summary of all interfaces, including their IP addresses and status. If your PPP interface shows up here with an IP address, it's another good sign, but we can go deeper. The show PPP multi-link command displays information about the multi-link PPP interfaces. This command is useful for troubleshooting, as it shows the number of links in the bundle, the load balancing method, and more. The show controllers command is another valuable tool. It provides detailed information about the physical interface, including the cable type, the controller state, and the received and transmitted data. Finally, the debug PPP negotiation command. This command allows you to see the PPP negotiation process in real time. It's a powerful tool for troubleshooting as it reveals any issues that occur during the negotiation. Each of these commands provides a piece of the puzzle. Together, they give a comprehensive view of the PPP configuration and its operation. This verification process is essential to ensure the network functions correctly. It allows us to catch and fix any issues before they impact the network's performance. That's how you verify a PPP configuration. Now, let's wrap up what we've learned today. We've covered a lot today, so let's summarize. We began our journey by diving into the world of wide area networks. We explored their basic concepts, how they bridge the gap between geographically separated local networks and their role as a backbone in today's interconnected world. Next, we shifted our focus to the point-to-point protocol, or PPP. We learned about its importance in establishing direct communication between two networking nodes. We went through the steps to configure PPP, highlighting the crucial role it plays in setting up a WAN connection. Then, we verified our PPP setup, a critical step to ensure the connection's operationality and performance. These fundamental concepts are stepping stones in the vast field of networking. They lay the groundwork for understanding more intricate topics like routing protocols and network security. Remember, understanding these basic concepts forms the foundation for more advanced networking topics. So keep learning, keep growing. Until next time, this is Tech Spectrum Pro signing off.